final de esta sesión, vamos a tratar de concretarlos en algunas propuestas y esencialmente en algunos puntos de debate hacia futuro. La mañana sin duda va a ser muy productiva, no solo por la calidad de los conferencistas, sino por los temas que ellos van a tocar, al igual que ayer. Iniciamos esta jornada con la presentación de Christine Johnson, que es la presidenta de la Comisión Especial de OTC de la ANDI, y aparte de eso es una persona que conoce muy bien este tema, a la sazón de que ella, siendo una ciudadana norteamericana, ha dedicado toda su carrera profesional en América Latina a temas que tengan que ver o a elementos desde el punto de vista conceptual que tienen que ver esencialmente con los productos OTC. Ha sido gerente de algunas de estas líneas, específicamente en algunas multinacionales en Colombia y en América Latina, y aparte de eso ha sido una activa representante del tema que tiene que ver con la relación directa entre los medios formales, oficiales y la regulación, y naturalmente con el desarrollo de estos temas. Christine nos hablará justamente de estos elementos de cooperación entre las agencias regulatorias y naturalmente la proyección de los elementos OTC. Bienvenida, Christine.
Bueno, I'm happy to be here to talk with you. I'm going to speak in English to give you an opportunity to not have to suffer with my American accent in Spanish, and to communicate. This is my mother tongue, to communicate even more. So I thought yesterday was a very, very good day. I personally learned a lot from other countries, some of the best practices there, and also hearing some of the different issues, let's say that new issues that we can start thinking about in our group, our strategic group for OTCs and dietary supplements, to support the government, the health authorities even more so. So I thought yesterday was a very, very good day. Today I'm going to be talking about the work we're doing with the health authorities, with INVIMA and the health ministry, on OTCs and dietary supplements. My presentation, I'm going to talk about the background on OTCs and dietary supplements here in Colombia, and then how these are promoted and sold in the marketplace. And then I'm going to talk about our work that we're doing in our strategic group itself, which was formed 3 years ago. As we heard yesterday, consumers are evolving, and there's a moving trend for self-care all over the world, and here in Colombia too. This is a U.S. study from 2015 in which we see that 92% of our consumers like being able to have better control of their health, that 88% feel confident in their ability to take responsibility for their health, and 64% feel they could be making more decisions on their health. Our lives are growing, are going faster, and our consumers, our patients, if the ailment is not serious, they want to save time and look for an OTC. From Google research, we learned that in our strategic group, that the Colombian consumers are connected. 31 million people in Colombia are using internet. That goes all the way down to the kids. There are more than 100,000 healthcare searches hourly in Colombia alone. And of that, 900,000 searches are done on analgesics in a month. 49% are now done on mobiles and mobile devices. The most popular searches are related to sexuality, digestive systems, and mental disorders. And if you look at it, mobile devices are becoming so prominent, and as we're on the go, almost the computer becomes old-fashioned as we do it. We look at it on our mobile devices before we enter into a pharmacy, or we're searching it on it as we're going through on Transmilenio or whatever to look for how to treat our common ailments. So we no longer have to wait to get information. We no longer have to go to the doctor and wait to get more information on what products to get, to look at. We research ourselves in cases, and since the government has also promoted internet accessibility and also mobile devices and computers, we don't have to pay a VAT tax on them. We are able to get these devices at a reasonable rate too. So Colombia becomes a very friendly environment for OTCs. If you look at it, OTCs and dietary supplements are now 40% of the retail market. And this is a high number because now there's more and more RX products sold into institutional channels. That's because of the health reform and the health coverage that we have, which is a very, very big health coverage in Colombia. We sell OTCs and dietary supplements through drug stores, supermarkets, and mom and pops, which are the tiendas de barrio. This means that the consumer can just walk into the store nearest to him, not doesn't have to take a public transport, buy his product for common ailments, and be able to treat himself in a responsible way because he's also researched beforehand or knows these brands from advertising, which I'm going to get into in a minute. And also we have a low price. Because of the competition at the point of sale and the fact that we offer a broad selection of products, and these are ones that the consumer can then research, and after the research at the point of sale, look at and compare formulas and pricing, that consumer obviously brings that price into perspective, and we as an industry have to take responsible price increases because we can price ourselves out of the market. So this is a positive situation. As we go forward, and consumers are comfortable with OTCs. This is a 2014 study that shows that consumers are smart and can self-medicate themselves with intelligence. 77.5% of the consumers surveyed in Colombia have self-medicated themselves once in their lives. This may be, let's say, less developed as in developed countries itself, but we are moving and we are transitioning itself. One third of the customers, the consumers, have surveyed had self-medicated themselves within last month. And they're doing that for the common ailments such as headaches, fever, and indigestion and such so forth. So they're getting their information beforehand and they're doing it for common ailments. In a 2013 study in LATAM, we see that consumers are deciding that an OTC purchase in advance. It's a planned purchase. And as we see, they are getting their information, we'll see in a minute, they're getting their information from advertising. Now, from this study, which is done in 2011, it's a little old, let's say, because internet is not as prominent here as it probably is right now. We see that the people in Colombia are getting their information from advertising and drugstore clerks. Yesterday, we talked about drugstore clerks and how we need to update them or have a more informed drugstore clerks themselves, but these are where they're getting their information and for their OTC purchases. Nowadays, new internet's, if we were to do this study now, I imagine that internet searches will be shown as much more prominent and trending upwards. But we're looking at the consumer that's getting their information from mass media. So that shows that we, as the industry, with the health authorities, have a responsibility to give clear, good, and true information to the consumer on internet and mass media. So the consumer healthcare industry has a responsibility to educate consumers through advertising. This responsible advertising would lead to a better informed consumer on product choices, also a consumer that's comprehension of the appropriate self-care, and to the reduction of the cost of the healthcare system. This is what we saw yesterday in other countries with actually some important information on how much it is actually bringing it down. We don't have those studies done in Colombia, but it is an impact to lower the cost of the healthcare system. This brings to a reduction of sanitary risk and misuse as an informed consumer can make his choices responsibly. Now, OTC advertisements in Colombia are highly regulated. And sometimes, as we saw yesterday from Dr. Guzman, this is needed because there are some companies and some distributors that have certain products and are not doing this responsibly and incorrectly. So we do need this type of regulations. Yet the regulations are not right now adapted to a modern consumer environment. Our latest advertising regulations come from a 2004 general advertising regulation. And you can imagine in 2004, digital was not as, definitely not as prominent as today. We were was much more backwards at that point. So, if you look at it, we're not in, was our current regulation is not specific for different media, digital or modern promotional activities. We needs to be updated. And this is something we'll be working on as an OTC and dietary supplement strategic group for next year to bring this into play. You can imagine, as we look at our approvals on digital, we have to have them pre-approved, and when a consumer has a question, he can't wait 2 months for an answer, a pre-approved answer from the health authorities. We need to act more quickly. We need to anticipate the questions that consumers will have. And we as an industry have the responsibility of giving them true information rather than getting them frustrated and allowing them to go into blogs that will give them information that's not true. We also have to bring speed to it. I mean, and there's another situation that as we look at it as an industry and in my company too, many times our banners and advertising space we have on digital, we cannot have all the information that Invima is asking us to have. We need to have something that is true, but at the same time expedited because the consumer is very fast and will not read through all the information that was required on it. So this is something we're looking at for the future. We know that the Invima is also doing their research on practices in other countries. And as we both go through as a strategic group of the industry looking at what we want to do and the Invima as what they're researching other countries, we will come together to work on this topic together. So who are we? Who are we as a group, as a strategic group of OTCs and dietary supplements? We have a mission and we have our objectives. This is very similar to the WSMI and the ILAR mission and objectives of them. We are country specific. Obviously, what we're looking for is to continue to help the consumer in this care of himself and to make his life better through a responsible self-medication. Our objective is to facilitate the OTCs to reach to the Colombian consumers, educate the consumer, encourage the reclassification of common molecules from RX to OTC, work closely with the government on these issues, promote the communication forums between the industry and the Invima itself, and that's very important because as a group, we can work together with the health authorities and not individually as companies. And that's bring out a forum in which there's more diverse interchange and opinions going forward. And obviously to look to bring it, to make sure that we get our objectives done on time. For those that are maybe new here, I invite you to come to our meetings. We are a group that was formed 3 years ago. Right now we're about 15 companies and growing. We work close with INVIMA and the health ministry, as I said before. We meet every 3 months in a general meeting in which we invite a speaker to come to talk to us, for example, Google, Nielsen, IMS, and the people. And the people who come together are the commercial people, the general managers, the commercial directors, along with the regulatory people. We have a specific agenda, as I said before. We do invite many times the INVIMA to talk about issues, and we're working very closely with them. And in fact, the team that we've formed with INVIMA has been excellent, because now we're talking. Teams are built over time. Teams are built when you face issues. Teams are built on respect, on being open with the people. In our meetings, it's been very good, because the INVIMA will ask us to be more, complete on our dossiers. We ask them to be more open on advertising. We talk in a very, very positive and environment, and that's very good. It's an open forum for the companies to bring in their issues and the health authorities at the same time. We have a report on the subcommissions, and here we have three subcommissions. Actually, there's a fourth one on the Pacific Alliance, and we have been able to get some good positive results over the last 3 years. Our advertising law, we have been able to refine it even further. This is one of the subcommissions on advertising. We have an RX to OTC switch committee in which we were able to get seven molecules switched from in 2014, end of 2014 into 2015. We are now working on a second list of OTC, RX molecules. And what we've done is with the INVIMA, with the IMS, IMS has presented to us the list of molecules, common molecules that are most prominent in other countries that are already OTC, which are not OTC in Colombia, and we're reviewing this list to bring it forward to the INVIMA for their consideration. Within the analysis that we do is not only on what molecules these are, but how big is that market for Colombia, if it's worthwhile or not, and also the medical evidence that we could present to help the INVIMA to study these molecules itself. So that's a very positive one. And our third one is on dietary supplements. Dietary supplements does have a law that is very vague. We need a little more definition on this, and we're working on this with the Pacific Alliance, seeing the best practices from Mexico, Chile, and Peru, in addition, and studying them in our group, our subgroup. So this has been positive. Now, we have already been seeing results, but there's more to be done. And here's our priorities for the coming months into the next year. We see the dietary supplement and definition and law refinement as important. One of the issues is the claims that we can do on dietary supplements, and we need to revisit this going forward, because serious dietary supplements that do have a medical evidence or support to them are not the same as other dietary supplements that are not that make more claims that are more broad. So we need to look at this, and we're looking this forward. We've already talked to the INVIMA, and this is one of the priorities that we'll be seeing for the very near future. One of the other ones is the better understanding of digital, as I said before. We are looking to reclassify more molecules from OTC, from RX to OTC. And we need alliances on topics with the Pacific Alliance as we go into more and more deeper discussions. So, in summary, we have a great team, and this is important as we get together with the health authorities in our meetings. You can see as we go more and more deeper, there's more and more respect between the two, between the industry and the health authorities itself. And going forward, I invite any companies that are not active to come become active. Send your commercial people to the meetings along with the regulatory people, because this makes it more a nutritive, very important part of going forward with our strategies as we go forward addressing issues on OTCs and dietary supplements. Thank you very much.
Gracias, Cristín. Un mercado que está ahí y que necesita obligatoriamente referenciarse a partir de relaciones claras entre los reguladores, los productores y esencialmente el papel activo de los consumidores. Reglas claras y un diálogo franco, sincero y constructivo, solicita o mejor propone Cristín, con componentes prácticos a partir justamente de su experiencia en el grupo de trabajo que en este momento tiene la interesante propuesta y obviamente su experiencia en el país ha sido determinante justamente en los últimos desenlaces que sobre este tema ha tenido no solamente la agencia regulatoria, sino también el mercado de estos productos en el país. Gracias, Cristina. Continuamos con el doctor Benjamin Carrick, él es el director de Política Global del Consumidor de Johnson & Johnson. Benjamín, después de una corta carrera como investigador, se unió a la industria hace ya algunos años y en la última década ha trabajado en ella específicamente en temas relacionados con el mercado OTC, en grandes multinacionales, actualmente lo hace en Johnson & Johnson. A lo largo de su carrera, básicamente se ha centrado en políticas de regulación y énfasis específicos en mercados, en el mercado de los productos de venta libre. También ha tenido relación directa y ha participado de manera protagónica en algunas organizaciones que tratan el tema de los OTC y hoy en día también es consultor de WSMI. Él nos hablará concretamente sobre el papel del valor de las marcas sombrilla en las medicinas sin prescripción, un tema del cual él es sin duda un conocedor en extenso. Bienvenido, Benjamin.
Thank you, everyone. I guess I should start by congratulating you on your result in the football yesterday. I was a little bit worried that if that result went badly, it would be a rather empty room this morning, but thankfully it went the right way. Firstly, I'd like to thank Andy for the opportunity to address this distinguished group and this important conference on self-care. The topic I've been asked to talk through today is the role and value of umbrella branding for non-prescription medicines, and in particular, I am representing the working group on that topic from the WSMI. So it's with thanks to all of the work that's gone on in that group. So firstly, I thought it was worthwhile just giving a very top line summary on the current landscape. And I think the most important thing to perhaps highlight at the outset is that umbrella branding for over-the-counter medicines is both well established and is accepted in many countries around the world. It's also important to acknowledge that brand names are not evaluated in isolation, and that other things, notably the packaging information and the pack design, can both link products but also differentiate them. And we shouldn't forget that many regulatory agencies review naming and packaging together and at the same time we'll come to an agreement with applicant companies on any necessary risk minimization strategies. So I thought it was also worthwhile early on in this presentation just to look at one or two definitions. So starting with brands. Well, brands aren't ingredients. What they are a number of images and ideas that could be used to publicly distinguish products from one another. Things like names and logos. If we then think about branding, well, we can define branding as the activities that are undertaken in order to raise the awareness and to shape the perception of brands. And it's important that we consider the links between trademarks and brand names and consider the different contexts in which they are used. Trademarks, of course, being used more in the legal context, where brand names are much more around the commercial issues of sales and marketing. And then when we consider over-the-counter medicines and think about umbrella branding, what we're talking about is the practice of using the same brand name across a range of products that are in similar or the same therapeutic areas. And then we should say an umbrella brand name is something that can help consumers when they're making a new purchase, and it helps them to identify the product and reduce uncertainty. And it's the packaging and advertising of the specific products within umbrella brands that allow consumers to understand the specifics of each product and make the appropriate product choice for their own needs. So how does branding work for consumers? Well, brands guide consumers to make them an appropriate and safe, effective choice with regards to their OTC medicines. And when gathering information ahead of a purchase, it's frequently the brand name that is the first piece of information that a consumer will have to help inform choice. And this allows them to distinguish between products and make correct choices. So the working... So the working group at the WSMI has worked on over the last 18 months or so, and we have a number of key messages. They're listed here. Don't worry about trying to read them all off the slide now. We'll go through them individually. But these are the key messages that I want to cover in this presentation today. So firstly, our initial key message. It's important to the industry to be able to use the same brand name for products with different ingredients in the same or related therapeutic categories. And to get a little bit further into some of the detail, well, why are brands important? Brands, they're all around us. We're used to seeing them in all areas of our life as consumers. But brands have become an indispensable guide to consumers. They're also critically important to companies because they enable a company to build its reputation and to build its image in the marketplace. That means that companies rely on brands when communicating about their products and their services. And that's why, as companies in this and other areas, we work so hard to build and to protect the equity of those brands. If we start to consider the role of brands with consumers rather than specifically companies, although it is important to remember that what's important to consumers with regard to branding is also important to companies, because at the end of the day, companies do depend on the choices that consumers make. But what does a brand do for a consumer? Well, the first thing that it does is it communicates the key attributes of a product, such as quality, and these are the things that consumers can then expect from those products. Through the advertising of brands, consumers are made aware of the different attributes of a brand that support the reputation, attributes such as reliability and functionality. And it's this awareness that is key to the consumer decision-making process and also, therefore, to companies. So it's very important to companies that brands deliver on the promises that they make to their consumers. If you don't deliver on those promises, you risk damaging not only the reputation of the product, but also the company. That can impact the use of those products, and it can also lead to criticism. There's also another element that's important to think about in this context, and that's the issue of innovation. And brand owners innovate. It's common for successful brand owners to be the innovators in any market. And it's that innovation and focus on what consumers want and need that drives research and development. And that, in turn, leads to the setting of standards that are taken up within the market by other players. It also plays an important role in supporting a dynamic and competitive market. And that's what makes companies work hard to improve their respective products and their respective services. So moving on to the second key message from the WSMI Working Group. If umbrella branding is not allowed for OTC medicines, then some products will simply not be marketed. Umbrella brands reduce the cost of bringing products to market and maintaining them in the market. The cost of developing and launching products, and that combined with the ongoing fixed marketing costs, can be high. And those costs are high irrespective of the value of that product and irrespective of the volume of sales of that product. So some products are standalone products, simply wouldn't be possible to bring to market on their own. However, umbrella branding provides economies of scale that support the development and marketing of those products. Without those economies of scale, some products would simply not be developed, would not be marketed, and would not be made available. And that impacts self-care and self-medication, it impacts consumer access to OTC medicines, and it also impacts the manufacturers. Moving on to the next key message. Familiarity with brands builds consumer confidence and helps them to identify the products that treat their symptoms. Trust and confidence in brands is something that consumers rate highly with regards to the choices they make with over-the-counter products. Some research that was carried out in 2013 in the United States looked into many questions about what drove consumers to make specific product choices. And one of the areas that came out very highly was, it is a brand that I trust. In fact, that scored as highly as having clinical data on effectiveness, and only just behind having clinical data on safety. So that data shows that consumers place a strong degree of importance in trust when it comes to selecting their products and the trust in those brands. Moving on to the next message. Regulatory and legal decisions about brand names must be made on a case-by-case basis. The information shown in the graph comes from a study carried out by the AESGP, the European OTC Association, and each year they look at many factors across around 45 countries around the world. And what that highlights is that in many countries, the majority of countries, some form of umbrella branding is accepted by the regulatory authorities. Now, there are many different forms of umbrella branding. For example, it can involve the same or different active ingredients, and it can involve the same or different therapy areas. But the important thing to point out here, as I say, is that the large proportion of regulatory agencies do accept some form of umbrella branding. Now, as applications for different products can be different, it's critically important that each one is considered on a case-by-case basis, and that it is also considered alongside other issues such as the packaging and product information. Now, many regulatory agencies will accept umbrella branding for products containing the same active ingredient and for the same or related indications. But it's often a much more difficult situation to get an umbrella brand name approved in other circumstances. That said, there is, for example, a recent case law from Germany that suggests that the courts will accept the use of different active ingredients for the same indication where those ingredients have a similar pharmacological profile. The next key message. Clear differentiation between products in an umbrella brand range is essential, and pack design can help to deliver that. So what we're suggesting is that brand names should not be looked at in isolation. It's possible for different products within umbrella brand ranges to treat different symptoms, to have different formulations and strengths, and to be used by different patient groups. And as identified by the example on this slide, the packaging can help consumers to distinguish between products and to choose the appropriate product for the symptoms they have. And in this case, it shows the opportunity to use the branding and the packaging to differentiate between the type of product, the strength of the product, and the different user groups. Moving on to packaging signals. Well, as we've discussed, brands can play an important role in helping consumers to identify products as familiar and trusted. And that can be a key point in their information collection on products. And when considering umbrella brands, it's important that the products can be identified as part of that trusted and familiar brand, whilst also balancing the need to clearly show the important information that avoids consumer confusion or potential harm. Indeed, that's a fundamental principle of OTC branding, to avoid consumer confusion and to avoid harm. So if we look at the differentiation with umbrella branding and helping consumers to choose, we've already referenced that the brand name is often the starting point of a consumer journey when choosing a product. But the availability of different products within an umbrella brand range is key to avoiding consumer confusion. So it's important that there are other differentiating signals and that they are present and clear. So as shown by the examples on this slide, individual product packaging within an umbrella product range can support differentiation. And it's important to recognize that companies do not want to confuse consumers through their marketing. To do so would be viewed as a failure of marketing objectives. It's not in anybody's interest to do so. So turning to the final message, umbrella branding is a key driver of innovation for companies of all sizes, is a key intellectual property right, and a normal part of commercial life. So it supports innovation, and if we think about the branded manufacturers, they've developed many technologies and innovations that we now take for granted in the OTC environment. These include things like the product formulation innovations, tablets and capsules, sustained release, patches, dissolvable strips. It includes innovations around packaging, blister packaging, sachets. It also looks at things like combination and multi-symptom product innovations, so that more symptoms can be treated through a single product. And then it's also brought innovations through switching products to bring new ingredients and new indications to the OTC category. The branded advertising that accompanies these umbrella branded products also creates awareness around innovation. And this innovation supports the self-medication and the self-care environment by bringing more products to market in new areas with new indications. It's also important because it raises consumer awareness of the treatments that are available as well as for those conditions. And Dion referenced yesterday in his presentation the importance of, if a new indication or a new OTC category is made available, it's important that consumers are aware of the products that are also available to treat. And then we come to the issue of intellectual property and the role that brands and trademarks play. So for OTC medicines manufacturers seeking to build trusted brands, it's the trademarks and the brand names that become the important intellectual property. These are the assets that companies seek to nurture and to protect, because whilst patents may expire, brands that meet consumer and customer needs and expectations will continue to be valued and to be successful. And these are key factors that support the OTC medicines manufacturers to invest and to innovate, even where products will not be protected by patents. So in summary, I leave you with the key messages once more and highlight the fact that the WSMI looks forward to engaging alongside the local associations around the world to engage in constructive discussion and dialogue with regulatory agencies around the role and importance of OTC umbrella branding to self-care, to consumers, and to the industry. Thank you very much.
Importantes aportes sobre temas que pocos conocemos, porque pocos elementos tenemos alrededor justamente de estos componentes paraguas que sin duda dimensionan una proyección grande dentro de lo que son los mercados en otras latitudes. En Colombia apenas empezamos a conocer este tipo de cosas y sin duda se convierten en un punto relevante para el debate y para la discusión frente a la situación actual del sistema de salud. Muchísimas gracias, Ben. La influencia de las conductas del autocuidado de la salud. David Skinner, que es el consultor heurístico de WSMI, nos hablará de este tema y naturalmente nos dará algunos puntos que servirán para la discusión posterior sobre la base que es quizás uno de los activistas mayores desde el punto de vista holístico alrededor de este tema. Bioquímico, investigador y por encima de todo, como digo, un activista de verdad a nivel internacional en este tema. Bienvenido, David, y la verdad es que esperamos con mucho entusiasmo sus aportes porque conocemos también de sus ejecutorias. Bienvenido.
Well, thank you very much, and I'm very happy to be here. Also happy about the outcome for the soccer game yesterday. It was, I could hear the cheering in the streets, and it was quite exciting to see people lined up outside of the shops and trying to look in and catch a peek of a TV off in the corner, standing there for 2 hours doing that. That's dedication. One of the things I want to preface my presentation with is that this is the result of a fairly long and an intensive research study that was done by WSMI through several vehicles, including some eminent researchers who did very, very large meta searches for information on advertising and how people make choices. It became very clear because the exclusion criteria were simple. We accepted published and unpublished data, but we didn't accept opinion pieces. And if you do a literature search, you often find letters to the editor that don't have data, they're not data-driven. So we decided to exclude opinion and stick to things that we could show and demonstrate the points through evidence base. You've heard actually twice today already and in other forums, advertising mentioned. And so I'm going to start a little bit with advertising, but the purpose of this presentation is to give you a more fulsome picture of what people do when they go from awareness to need recognition to actual choice and then use and how that virtuous loop continues. Without knowing that context, advertising and any of the components, brands and brand value, all stand too much on their own and cannot be really truly evaluated without knowing how each contribute to each other to create the optimal situation for self-care. So I'm going to talk about three things. First is the decision-making process itself and what the major influences are on how consumers make choices. And then I'll offer a few conclusions at the end. So first of all, the search always starts with a recognition that there is a health-related need to be addressed. Then the next step towards finding a solution is to gather information about the available options. And the way that people search for and purchase and use products for self-medication is highly influenced by the amount and type of information available. But there are a number of steps along the way to making a final decision to purchase and to use a self-medication product. This graphic you've seen as well, and I'm going to take you a little bit more through the details of this, but I mentioned just a second ago that this is a what we would call a virtuous circle, one that continues to build upon itself, and this you'll see through some of the evidence-based studies around what the value is of having trust in a product that arises from successful outcomes and results in successful repeated purchase and use of medications that will solve problems, health-related problems, for consumers. Because after all, that is what it is all about. So the first thing we need to look at is the awareness phase. Now, here, I want to just draw attention to the fact that advertising is not a single kind of term that you can use generally. There is broadcast advertising, there's print advertising, there's the web that's been growing like crazy, there's social kinds of media that can be used to get out messages. So not all sizes, there's not one size fits all. Each kind of medium that you can use can be used differently. I would say that advertising is the least effective tool for any kind of educational messaging, but that also depends on the platform you're using. If it's a 15, 30 second commercial in electronic media, you have much less time to communicate much in the way of educational messages, but if you have a website, then there's maybe more opportunity. But we'll come to see how people look at these kinds of advertising tools and begin to understand more readily that advertising is really just about awareness. So even in the absence of illness, there's a period prior to need recognition that's important to the eventual search process. Advertisements provide information about branded products and what health benefit they can be expected to provide. And the main purpose of advertising is to create awareness and to differentiate products from each other. This does not mean that every viewer of an advertisement is interested in the product or that every exposure leads to a sale. So advertising in the absence of a self-care need is crucial because they help shape the initial consideration set. So as we get through this, you'll see that there are a number of things that people look for in terms of information sources that allow them to more finely tune their search process until they arrive at a rational choice. Since no advertiser would ever know when a person has recognized a health concern that they wish to address, they cannot provide what would be considered just-in-time information about their products. So in terms of advertising as an awareness tool, it needs to be pervasive, persistent, and consistent. So having consistent messaging about solutions to self-care really is about having different channels that are preferred by different people, and that increases the likelihood that when a health need does arise, there's an awareness that there are some things that might be available. This is my favorite example. Say you're watching a soccer game, football game, and an advertisement comes on TV for Athlete's Foot Remedy. But if you don't have Athlete's Foot Remedy, this is not going to make you go buy an Athlete's Foot Remedy. However, there is now an awareness. And if you watch a lot of sports, you may see a lot of exposures to the awareness that there is a solution for athlete's foot. And when the need does arise, and you do recognize that you've got that itchy, tingly feeling in your foot, now you can start your search process. Because you know already that there is something that could be useful for this. But it doesn't stop there. You don't just say, I know this, and gee, I think I recall the brand from my advertising. There are a number of other steps to go in before you actually pick that product off the shelf and then use it. So advertising for consumer health products are perceived differently when compared with other kinds of goods that consumers buy. They don't consider OTC ads as emotional. They're firstly informative. The adjectives entertaining and emotional perform less well than information when people are tested about how do they perceive ads for OTCs. They perceive that ads for OTCs tell more important things. In a multi-country study, this is actually examined, and all you really need to know about these slides is that 100 is the index for all consumer goods, so which include, say, kitchen articles, electronics, as well as OTCs. And in this slide and the subsequent slide, you'll see that consumers believe that the messaging around OTC advertising is much more prominent on the information side. Numbers about entertaining and emotional often come down much lower than the average for all other consumer goods. So you see this was done in the UK, the US, there's some Canadian and Australian data, but it's consistent throughout the world. And it's not a coincidence, I don't believe, that in each of these countries there are similar kinds of environments, both regulatory and self-regulatory, for advertising practices. So once we move away from understanding that there's a need, that there is an awareness, that we come to the point where we have a need recognition, and this is where I was saying before about the athlete's foot. Once I think I have a need for something like this, what steps do I have to go through now? And this is a lot of times where once a person has recognized the need, they decide to take further action, that advertising now plays the least significant role in the selection of the appropriate product. When a person decides that some action is desired and to manage their health concern, they begin to search for more information, more in-depth information. And the vast majority of touch points during the information search phase involves consumer-driven information seeking. So when you think about advertising, it's much more there in front of the consumer. They're not asking for it particularly, but once they recognize the need, now they're going to start driving the search process. So what do they look for first? The top three resources, and we've seen these in other slides as well, are the physician, family and friends, and the pharmacist. With the physician and family and friends being the two most important across many different countries. And once a person begins a search for information, advertising and other passive information tools are given much less weight in the evaluation process. So product advertising, for example, when you're looking at, all right, I have a need, I'm going to try and find something, I got to find trusted information sources. And advertising as a trusted information source is very low with respect to other kinds of information sources. And this slide, while very busy, I'll draw your attention to a few things. One is that there's a high degree of support for doctors and family and friends as information sources. And if you look in the far right side of the slide here, you'll see that the health practitioner has a very high average confidence level. So not only are doctors often, most often, consulted about kinds of ailments, particularly the first time these things occur for a consumer, they have a high degree of trust in that. Second is, they will, while Google actually is in there, and we've heard other people comment about the growth of electronic searches, at this point in time, Google's trust level is only 40%. So a lot of people Google, but it's not the be-all, end-all. They don't just stop there. They say, well, it might be right, it might not be, but it starts me on my path. Now, this sounds like a very complex kind of thing. Believe me, it is. But if you just think about yourself and how you go about your daily business, you're making very, very complex decisions all day long. They come naturally to you because you've been doing them all your life. But when you actually break down and look at the behavioral science behind all of this, it becomes more apparent that there are a lot of factors considered towards the eventual purchase and use of a product. I want to mention a little bit about social media. It's the very bottom. This is a little older study. So social media comes up a little bit more often now. But it is actually a proxy for friends and family. So if you think about people that go on Facebook and they type in, I'm not feeling very well today, anybody ever felt like this? And their friends, their Facebook friends, and one might argue whether they're really friends or not, but within their community, they get feedback. So the social media side is really very much a proxy for family and friends, and that really, when you add that to the direct conversations you may have with family and friends, I'd say that's getting up there pretty high. So this is the same slide that Ben showed. What I wanted to point out here is that the things that are most important, take a look at the top ones. They're looking for efficacy and safety. Those are the kinds of things that they are really searching for, is data on efficacy, well, data. They're looking for information on, does the product work? Is the product safe? You'll see that at this point in time, when they're starting to do a more in-depth search, that advertising really plays a very minor role. This is just another graphic representation from a different study that emphasizes that physicians and family and friends are very, very important, probably the two most important. But the actual subtle difference in this slide is it does show that when people are faced with more serious ailments, and they're usually pretty good at understanding when it's a little more serious than a minor ailment, then they tend to really absolutely go to see the doctor for it. So a fairly rational decision-making process. But we move to the next stage. Okay, now you've gathered all this information. How do you evaluate the information? Well, you have a number of alternatives, and you're going to use a number of different tools to evaluate whether these pieces of information are valid in your circumstances. So during the stage where a person examines their choices in response to their health needs, they need to take into consideration a number of potential actions that they could do. They may choose to do nothing, purchase a product for self-care, seek the information from a health professional. But it's clear that even though you say, I have this condition, you may choose to do nothing about it. You may simply say that this is not that serious. Or you may say, I think this is a little bit more serious and I want to do something and then I'm going to get my alternatives evaluated. Or very serious, I'm going to go see my doctor. So one of these studies showed that 46% of people weighed their alternatives and chose to do nothing about their minor ailment. 27% of the people used an OTC medicine to deal with their condition. And it's interesting that people who choose to do nothing rather than treat an illness really did cite perceived lack of severity, that the condition doesn't really need a treatment, or it will resolve itself in a very short period of time. So it's clear that, you know, once you are aware you have a need and you're aware that there's information sources, that not all the time does that actually mean that you actually go out and do something to purchase a product. So once a decision is made, did I push that forward? I'm sorry. Yeah. There's a need to act. They have to gather the information about the available options. And it's the time that product alternatives start to arise in the selection process. And how they choose and assess these alternatives, it depends on the number of choices they have and their own personal selection criteria. So if you only have one choice, it's much simpler. But if you have several choices, then you have given many more options. And you have to layer on that some filters about how you personally perceive these kinds of factors and weigh them yourselves. So they compare various products. All the products that they hopefully are comparing are addressing the need that they have, and then make choices from there by evaluating things. So the criteria that guide evaluation can either be objective or subjective. The subjective aspects are often guided by existing attitudes, and this is where I mentioned before about, okay, one of my choices is to do nothing because my attitude is I'm going to brave it out. So I'm a pretty tough person. I like to tough things out. I've got a strong constitution. That's a subjective attitudinal factor that factors into the evaluation process. So with respect to objective assessment of options, a decision filter is employed where various product attributes are considered. And by that I mean, and we'll just focus on one side here, once you've said, I think a product might be the best choice for me, you have another series of decision filters, and if you look at the cough cold side, while not these things don't actually trigger down in this order necessarily, they're not necessarily successive, but the things that you are looking at is what is the brand, what form is it in, is it liquid, is it a tablet, is it a capsule, does it address my symptom, is it in a flavor or a form that I prefer, is it the right size for me? Do I only need it for a short time, or do I perceive this is going to exist for longer? And then ultimately at price, and I will talk about price as a factor in a little while. So we're closing in on the end of the process where you actually make a purchase. And the purchase decision is made on a number of factors that once you've done an evaluation, done an assessment, and said, I'm going to go and buy something, you have to get up out of wherever you are and go to the place where you can purchase this. And unlike most consumer decisions, these are complex, as you've seen so far, and there are often numerous inputs into the final decision. One of the largest influences on a decision about health action occurs at the moment a person faces a decision to select a product from the shelf. So there are a number of other aids for how that happens. Store layout does help guide people to the location where the products will be found. And navigating the retail area is followed by another set of selection criteria. So when you start in the store, how do you find your way to the product? Well, there's typically products are organized in the following fashion. There's a therapeutic area, and it has an aisle. And then in the aisle, you have shelves. And in the shelves, a lot of the indications are grouped together. And then you get down to this grouping that meets up with your symptoms. And now you have a number of brands that you can choose from. And this is where brand trust can play in. And at the end of this, you are now going to have to make a decision amongst your choices and facing you. But once in front of the products, people review some of these things again because now they have real hands on, they're about to make a decision. Some studies I've seen say that when you're a first-time purchaser, so you've never had this condition before, and you go in and you're standing in front of the selection, that you sometimes take up to 10 minutes to actually stand and compare labels. People are less worried about comparing prices than they are making sure that the product labels have the right indications, and you're also much more likely to seek advice at the store shelf level from a pharmacist. So in terms of the relative utilization of in-store information to help narrow the search, obviously signage is very high, then category-specific signage, brands, and then, as I mentioned before, the least of all is 14% people say that price has an influence on their final decision. Christine had a slide as well about low price. And probably one of the reasons why price is such a low feature in this is that the competitive environment in OTC is so strong that the prices are generally very, very, very affordable. So the final moment of decision influencers include past experience with a particular brand is a good practical indicator for a repeat purchase. And this gets back to that virtuous circle again. Label reading is a very, very big thing. So if there's not been a past experience, this is where people spend more time reading the labels and asking a pharmacist. In other words, so they asked the pharmacist, only 9.5% said they never, which means that over 90% of people, when they're facing a first-time choice, do ask for help. So the evidence would seem to support a consumer behavior that seeks a retail environment where there are multiple sources of information when making a selection for the first time. But after the initial use and satisfaction with the outcomes, the consumers may look to make repeat purchases without the need for such a fulsome external input. So 3 to 5% of respondents say that they would do something different next time, which means that, generally speaking, the product performed well for them and say they will repeat their purchase the next time they have such a need. Okay, so now they've bought it, they take it home and they have to use it, and this is the last step in the virtuous circle, is that good use and responsible use of the product results in positive outcomes, which actually lend credence to brand trust and repeatable purchase behavior. So successful outcomes made by a consumer can reinforce their ability to deal with future occurrences of the same health need. The value of success of the particular brand is it can provide a touch point for consumers when they decide to take action. And building trust with a brand, this goes back to Ben's comment about line extensions and so on, can pay dividends in helping with their search process the next time that they may have a different indication. So after, just going back and touching on responsible use, so high satisfaction levels always correspond to proper use of products. And you don't use the product properly, generally speaking, your outcomes are not optimal, and therefore you say, I didn't have a good experience with that, I'm not going to do that again. This slide, really just looking at some of the most common ailments and satisfaction with outcomes, all you simply say in this slide is that the satisfaction levels are very high, and that very high satisfaction level does tend to lead to repeat behaviors. Adherence to label instructions is a key indicator of the likelihood of a positive health outcome, and studies show that label reading is particularly high amongst first-time users, And the greater familiarity with a product, i.e. repeated purchase, the more the person will rely on a behavior that they had before. In other words, you invest a lot in your initial decision, your initial use. When you have a successful outcome, the next time you have a similar need, you don't have to go through all of these steps. Because it does seem like a pretty onerous and pretty complex decision-making process. And the fact of the matter is, it is, but most particularly for first-time indications. So if you look at the combination of every time and almost every time, that's 83%, which is a very high compliance rate. This is thinking about every any time you use it. So this, after you've got the product home, and let's say you've used it before and you go and repurchase another one, even before you're going to use it again, what's your level of looking at, you know, am I taking the right number of tablets or the right dosage? And very high compliance levels with that decision, with the label reading. In this slide, this again reinforces the first point at 90% is read the instruction for taking it the first time. So it's just more data that supports the original concept about first-time use. But then the next two questions are really good measures and proxies for responsible use that even when I using medicine treatment you can buy, you should always be careful, you should only take medicines when necessary. Those numbers are very high. So closing in and on towards the end of the post-purchase behavior part of the cycle is just another slide that really reinforces the comments I made earlier about in-store selection and first-time use. So people do tend to use the products they select successfully, and this contributes to brand satisfaction and the intention to repurchase when the same need arises. Not only does a successful outcome create a positive input to future purchases, it also results in people making recommendations to friends and family. And what's the number two source of information when you're searching for a new category? Friends and family. So again, a virtuous circle. I'll take you some of the conclusions. It's really just restating what I've stated about this virtuous circle. That the influences on consumer decision-making process are numerous, and the process itself is sophisticated relative to how purchase decisions are made for many other consumer goods. The wide variety of product information sources play a role in creating awareness of available solutions for self-care health needs. Most people often see an advertisement in various media when they do not have an existing health need. However, once a person has identified a need, the awareness created by advertising can lead to the next steps in the search process. An awareness of advertising for a product previously purchased and used successfully can help reinforce a brand's value by reminding the consumer of its availability. Once a person recognizes a healthcare need and they decide that some action is necessary, they seek information to assess their alternatives, and the main sources of information people use are health professionals, friends, and family. During the evaluation stage of the decision-making process, many people will choose to do nothing. However, choosing to purchase a product to deal with their health concern is also a major course of action. And the selection of a particular brand becomes more focused as the person takes the final steps towards a purchase of a product at the retail shelf, and then after the product is chosen and purchased and used successfully for the intended purpose, the person has a new baseline of experience to inform future actions when he or she faces the same or similar needs. So ultimately, the conclusion is that the decision-making process that people employ to address health needs is considerably more deliberate than one might imagine. And there are many inputs to the final actions taken, and they're all important to the understanding of how people behave in response to an identified health need. And I believe that that whole concept of how people behave, how they think, is very good background and context to use when you're looking at any one of the components inside that process, be it advertising, brands, in-store, or whatever aspect leads to the final responsible use and successful outcomes. Thank you.
Gracias, David. No nos equivocamos, por lo menos yo, cuando esperaba la conferencia de David. A ver si entendí. Cuando uno ve la publicidad de un producto, uno no tiene la necesidad. Voy a trasladar esto a la Colombia, David, con todo respeto. Entonces, uno está almorzando y ve, por ejemplo, una cuña de la onicomicosis. Entonces, aparece a la hora del almuerzo, que uno de pronto ve el noticiero, una uña que parece una milhoja ahí, y entonces eso no... A mí pueda que no me impacte, además de decir, pero ¿por qué a la hora del almuerzo? Al poco tiempo, empiezo a crear la necesidad y entonces... Claro, como estoy influenciado, me empiezo a mirar las uñas y cuando ya no tengo 1,000 hojas, sino de pronto 40 hojas, digo, ¿será que necesito esta vaina, sí o no? Y entonces empiezo a pensar y de pronto digo, no, todavía no, y no hago nada. Esto es suave, tranquilo, esto simplemente, de pronto dejando el pie ventilado, eso se me pasa. Pero si sigue creciendo, entonces, ¿qué hace uno? Uno llama a un amigo o al hermano. O a la señora, dice, oiga, ¿será que esto necesita algo? ¿Sí o no? De pronto sí, de pronto no, pero cuando uno no tiene nada, le entendí, entonces uno va a quien ha reemplazado la familia, que son las redes sociales. Entonces uno pone ahí, al aire, y dice, oiga, tengo esto, y manda la foto. Y le aparecen muchas personas que le dicen, de pronto sí necesita eso. Entonces uno se queda pensando... Y entonces tengo que comprar esa vaina. Uno aquí habla de esa vaina, habla del producto. Entonces uno se va, ¿a dónde? A una farmacia, estamos en la Colombia. Y uno se va a una farmacia en donde le aparecen no el farmacéutico, sino le aparecen son las imágenes de los personajes importantes que se echan esos productos. Entonces está el producto que se echa Jorge Barón, el producto que se echa Juan Pablo Raba, el producto que se echa el presidente Santos, y uno empieza a pensar que cuál será mejor. El precio sí importa, David. Porque uno lo primero que pregunta es cuál es el más barato. Y toma la decisión y después de que uno se unta eso, uno empieza a comparar después a la hora del almuerzo. Cada vez le llama la atención. Entonces sí influye en la toma de conciencia posterior la publicidad porque refuerza el asunto. Entonces está la uña ahí y sí me ha servido. Y cada vez que uno ve que crece, entonces la marca le gusta y vuelve y se lo aplica y lo recomienda. Entonces cuando le llega a uno la foto por el WhatsApp de otro amigo, dice, este producto me sirvió. ¿Entendí, David, más o menos? Ok, entonces más o menos eso dentro de un marco que nos permite tomar algunas referencias, digamos, particulares. Interesante. No es fácil eso de la toma de decisiones, sobre todo en un sistema en el que uno deja para lo último el asunto. Entonces, ¿será que sí, será que no? Y la toma de decisiones muchas veces en nuestro país, desafortunadamente, es un poco tardía. Terminamos antes del receso con la conferencia de Juan Tonelli, que es la experiencia de los países latinoamericanos sobre el autocuidado de la salud y las tareas de Hilar. Hilar es la Asociación Latinoamericana de Productos de Venta Libre. Juan Tonelli es administrador de empresas de la Universidad de Buenos Aires, ha sido ganador de la medalla de oro del Instituto Nacional de Liderazgo Político del Ministerio, otorgada por el Ministerio del Interior de Argentina, ha sido director comercial de los corredores médicos y consultor de la firma, de la principal firma de sistemas de seguridad de la salud en Argentina, director ejecutivo de la Asociación Argentina de Productores OTC, y actualmente es el director general de la, como decíamos, de la Asociación Latinoamericana de Productos de Venta Libre. 15 años de experiencia en estos temas de OTC, regulaciones, gobierno y demás. Bienvenido, Juan, y esperamos también su conferencia.
Perdón, pero salí a tomar una llamada de urgencia. A mí me pidieron que pusiera el fondo en inglés y que hablara en castellano, así que como hay todo tipo de presentaciones, voy a seguir las indicaciones que me dieron acá los amigos de Andy. Para ir un poco más al punto, le voy a pedir al que pasa los... ¿O se pasan de aquí? ¿Los slides? ¿De aquí? ¿Para pasar? Ok. Ahí va. Voy a pasar un poco. Así vamos directo. Perfecto. Yo dirijo ILAR ahora hace un par de años, que es una asociación que tiene como 15 años, que empezó acá con mucho esfuerzo y la dirigió muchos años nuestro amigo Héctor Bolaños, y que nuclea a las asociaciones y a las empresas de la región de aquí, de Latinoamérica. Hace un par de años que yo estoy liderando este proyecto y un poco tratamos de ir encontrando un camino en lo que hacía a una asociación regional que tenía bastantes desafíos, ¿no? Porque el principal, la heterogeneidad de los países de nuestra región, que tienen sus similitudes pero también sus diferencias importantes. Después, la ausencia de un organismo, si se quiere, supranacional como existe en Europa, de una agencia reguladora europea, acá no hay. Entonces, la posibilidad de coordinar trabajos con los distintos gobiernos es bastante difícil. Colombia participa de todo lo que es la Alianza Pacífico, que es sumamente interesante y está avanzando. Esta semana tuvieron avances muy importantes. ¿Me escuchan? Empezamos de vuelta, entonces. Menos mal que Rodrigo me dijo ahora, si no, terminaba y me decían que no me habían escuchado nada. Vamos de vuelta. Bueno. Le decía que una de las dificultades más importantes que tenemos cuando pensamos un trabajo en toda la región... ¿Ahí va mejor? Bueno, el que no escucha, levanta la mano que no muerdo. Es combinar con países que tienen bastantes diferencias y que no hay ningún acuerdo operativo importante de todos los países de esta región, por lo menos los principales. Hay algunos sectores, ¿no? La comunidad andina, está el Mercosur, que mucho no funciona, está ahora la Alianza Pacífico, que parece muy auspicioso e interesante, pero cuando miramos Latinoamérica como un todo, no hay un tratado suficientemente operativos que funcionen. Entonces, tratar de pensar en políticas públicas comunes a esa región es bastante difícil porque en el fondo no hay incentivos de los gobiernos y de las agencias a trabajar conjuntamente, ¿no? Buena parte de los funcionarios de las agencias de esos países se ofrecen a trabajar y tratar de buscar soluciones a los problemas que vemos juntos, más por una buena actitud que porque sea una responsabilidad de ellos, porque no está en su programa. Así que un poco lo que nos planteamos hace un par de años fue ir buscando un camino común, al menos entre los principales países de la región. Tomamos inicialmente 6, que eran México, Venezuela, Colombia, Brasil, Argentina y Chile. Después lo redujimos un poco más al grupo y nos quedamos con México, Colombia, Brasil y Argentina. Y el camino que elegimos un poco fue poner el foco en investigaciones, algo de lo que vienen viendo bastante aquí, así que lo vamos a tratar de no ser redundantes, pero tratar de poder diseñar investigaciones en forma conjunta con las agencias reguladoras y hacerlos conjuntamente, ¿no? No está una modalidad que también se usa mucho, es muy válida, que era hacer la investigación y después llevársela a mostrar al gobierno, sino hacerla con ellos. Eso creo que fue un rasgo bastante distintivo y muy interesante. Desde ese punto de vista, lo que de las metodologías que fuimos buscando hacer fue armar lo que nosotros llamamos un grupo OTC, donde juntamos las principales personas de las principales agencias de estos 4 países que le contaba: COFEPRIS en México, INVIMA aquí en Colombia, ANVISA en Brasil y ANMAT en Argentina, que hubiera gente de staff y gente también con capacidad de decisión política para tratar de ir explorando ciertas problemáticas y poder ir encontrando soluciones. Ese fue el eje de nuestra propuesta, ¿no? Que estamos transitando. Acá están las agencias. Esto era un poco lo que les decía, ¿no? De los desafíos con los que nos topamos. El principal es la falta de integración regional, ¿no? Cuando se habla de Latinoamérica como un todo, lo único que nos une es el varias cosas, ¿no? Pero el idioma es claramente. Después el resto de diversidades muy importantes y los acuerdos de gobierno todavía son más un sueño y un anhelo que una realidad. El segundo punto que siempre lo pongo para provocar un poco es que las leyes son optativas, ¿no? Una cosa que es muy interesante ver es esta idea de la categoría OTX que tenemos acá en la región, ¿no? Cuando uno mira las mediciones de ventas de los productos de la región, siempre aparece y se habla con total naturalidad de esta categoría OTX, ¿no? Que son todos los productos de prescripción que se pueden comprar sin ninguna prescripción. Nosotros en Argentina siempre decimos, bromeando, que todo es medicamento de venta libre, porque las personas se pueden comprar lo que quieran, un psicotrópico, un antibiótico, no. Parece un tema gracioso, pero en el fondo es un gran obstáculo al desarrollo del autocuidado, al desarrollo del sector OTC. ¿Por qué? Porque la confusión es importante, porque si no se mejora ese punto, todo lo demás es muy complejo. O sea, muchas veces estamos discutiendo los switches y la premura, el apuro que tienen las autoridades por ocuparse del tema es mucho menor, porque saben que en el fondo igual, si la gente lo necesita, se lo puede comprar. Entonces, ¿para qué apuro tenemos en clasificarlo como OTC? No existe esta situación que se da en Europa, que uno sin la prescripción no se puede comprar el medicamento. Mucho menos muchos de esos estudios que se hacen sobre el impacto económico que se pierde por no tener un medicamento de venta libre y tenerlo como medicamento de prescripción, ¿no? Esos estudios que muestran la pérdida de la persona para ir al consultorio, que le hagan la prescripción, que vuelva a la farmacia, que se lo compre, se lo tome, y toda esa catástrofe que se produce. Acá, mala persona, se pide el psicotrópico y se lo toma y se terminó. No digo que sea así en Colombia, pero es la realidad bastante en la región. Entonces, este hecho que lo miramos con simpatía termina impactando mucho, porque toda la mirada y todo el trabajo está muy teñido de eso, ¿no? Y que, por supuesto, es un problema muy complejo. Pretender simplificarlo en el gobierno, en las empresas, en la farmacia, es un problema muy complejo que creo que es una deuda pendiente que nunca está muy abordada, ¿no? Hay países de la región que han avanzado bastante, por lo menos en controlar las principales categorías, pero es un tema pendiente que nos condiciona mucho el trabajo. Los dos puntos finales que agrego como marco de referencia, uno es la inestabilidad política que tenemos, ¿no? Tenemos muchas idas y vueltas. Hoy estamos viendo lo que pasa en Brasil, Argentina está en una situación muy delicada, Venezuela lo dejamos del grupo porque era imposible trabajar. Muchos de los países de la región tienen muchas olas que hace difícil y trabajoso el trabajo. Y también nuestra condición latina, que es apasionante, pero que también es a veces limitante, ¿no? Nosotros, si miramos, por ejemplo, la CHPA, que es la Cámara de Estados Unidos, básicamente de las 40 personas que trabajan ahí, 38 son técnicas. Y las discusiones que tienen con la FDA y con el gobierno de Estados Unidos son técnicas en su 95%. Si nosotros hacemos un análisis de nuestra región y cómo funcionan las asociaciones y la interacción con el gobierno, la verdad que el componente emocional es muy alto, ¿no? Y uno se topa muchas veces con discusiones donde cuesta volver a llevar las conversaciones a un cauce de racionalidad. Tenemos un componente humano y emocional muy alto. Y que todas las extrapolaciones que pretendemos hacer de países desarrollados a veces se topan con nuestra, latinidad, por decir la palabra. Y también la burocracia creciente que nos alcanza a todos, ¿no? Empresas, asociaciones, gobiernos, que resulta mucho más trabajoso mover, ¿no? Todos los que ustedes trabajan en empresas lo podrán saber. Antes, ¿no?, era bastante más simple moverse, ahora para cada cosa hay que tener 10 calls, hablar con 20 personas, convencer a uno, termina siendo como un líder religioso casi, para poder mover maquinarias muy pesadas, ¿no? Increíblemente. Voy a tratar de pasar por encima. ¿Cuánto era el tiempo, perdón, Rodrigo, de esto completo? Media hora. ¿Media hora incluye las preguntas? ¿Sí, ahí? ¿Eh?
Perfecto.
Estamos perfecto. Bueno. Voy a tratar de pasar muy por encima un poquito algunas de las investigaciones que hemos haciendo en ILAR, que fueron siempre a nivel regional, ¿no? Algunas arrancamos con los 6 países que les conté, otras fuimos a 5, otras a 4, pero, no, pero ninguna de estas está en menos de 4. Y algunas, como la del caso de Umbrella Brands, de Marcas Paraguas, está en curso, así que todavía no les puedo, solamente les contaré por encima qué es lo que estamos haciendo. La primera que compartimos es la de etiquetas. El año pasado hicimos un estudio muy intenso que estuvo inspirado en un proyecto inicialmente fue en Australia hace muchos años, después en México, después lo hicimos en Argentina y el año pasado decidimos llevarlo a toda la región, que fue hacer 3 etapas de investigación con Ipsos. Tomamos 5 países, ¿no? México, Colombia, Brasil, Argentina y Chile. Y ver, la primera etapa era un estudio cuantitativo, muy robusto en casos en cada país. Dependiendo del tamaño del país, teníamos entre 500 y hasta 1000 casos en los países más grandes, como el caso de Brasil. Que lo que queríamos ver era qué porcentaje de las personas leían las etiquetas, de ese porcentaje cuántas comprendían, si les resultaban amigables y se invitaban a leer o si les resultaban repulsivas, por así decirlo. La primera etapa. La segunda, tal vez la más rica, fue hacer grupos focales, focus groups, también en todos esos países, para ver, para conocer más en profundidad y delinear una posible etiqueta sencilla, amigable, que tuviera 2 cosas, ¿no? El primer objetivo era que invitara a las personas a leer, ¿no? Parece casi obvio, pero era el primer objetivo que nos planteamos, ¿no? Y el segundo, que la información fuera corta, concisa y a la altura de lo que estaban buscando las personas. Ahí hubo y hay una tensión que cada vez va a ser más grande, que es en este exceso de información en el que vivimos, gracias a todos los medios e internet básicamente, nos hemos puesto insoportablemente ansiosos, ¿no? Nadie quiere leer nada, ¿no? Es la era de Twitter, donde los 140 caracteres mandan. ¿Quién no ha experimentado que cuando se compra un equipo de lo que sea, está la guía larga y después uno a duras penas lee el resumen ejecutivo de una carilla ya con impaciencia, ¿no? Y iPhone que te vende el teléfono y ya no tiene ni instrucciones, ¿no? Pese a usarlo. Total, ¿para qué hacemos ese libro que nadie lee? Esto que parece gracioso aplica también a los medicamentos, ¿no? Hay una tensión, ¿no?, entre autoridades preocupadas porque la gente tenga acceso a toda la información, empresas que también quieren que tengan acceso a la información y no sentir que pueden estar utilizando mal sus productos y tener problemas, y personas que no quieren leer casi nada, ¿no? Queremos como usuarios una situación casi mágica que en 140 caracteres nos digan qué, cómo. Con esa perspectiva encaramos este estudio y encontramos cosas que no deben sorprender a nadie, pero una cosa es pensarlas, conjeturarlas, y otra cosa distinta es, bueno, comprobarlas, ¿no? Entonces, como algunas de las conclusiones que fuimos encontrando, ¿no?, que la organización de la información ayuda a que esté más organizada, que el uso de íconos es valorado, aunque a veces los íconos pueden generar confusión, por lo cual también es bueno testearlos, no necesariamente son totalmente precisos, en algunos casos pueden presentar alguna ambigüedad en la comprensión de las personas. Fíjense que la referencia que nos pasaron fue de 3.000 caracteres como límite, ¿no? Y hoy, si tomamos en estos países, el promedio excede con creces, ¿no?, de la longitud. Y la tolerancia, el umbral de la gente, donde ya está fastidiada de seguir leyendo, son 3.000 caracteres para una medicina. Y si tomamos, no quiero ni dar nombres de países, no es el caso de ustedes, pero algunos de los países de aquí también tienen. Recuerdo en un focus group, que siempre lo cuento como un hecho gracioso, uno de los países había estado trabajando mucho en mejorar las etiquetas, como 3 años, hicieron un proyecto nuevo, lo pusieron en vigencia, la etiqueta, las indicaciones sigue siendo muy extensa, ¿no? Entonces en los grupos focales llegaron las autoridades a ver qué es lo que pasaba. Y en el primer minuto, una de las personas que estaba en el grupo focal abre, porque era un folleto, ¿no?, abre el folleto y lo primero que dice es: esto parece un diario de domingo. Y las autoridades se miraron casi escandalizadas, como diciendo: estuvimos 3 años trabajando convencidos que esto es buenísimo y esta persona nos viene a decir en el primer segundo que esto parece un diario de domingo, que necesito 2 horas y un café con leche para poder leerlo, ¿no? Evidentemente, la distancia entre lo que demanda ese usuario, esa persona, y lo que pretendía hacer el gobierno con las mejores intenciones, eran dos lugares que había una brecha enorme, ¿no? Entonces, fíjense que el máximo que nos daban los estudios es 3.000 caracteres como el umbral de tolerancia a la lectura. El tamaño de letra también es otro clásico, y también acá siempre están las restricciones. Quiero poner tantas cosas que al final la letra necesita un microscopio, ¿no?, para poder leerla, o que venga el medicamento con una lupa, como cuentan algunas abuelas que venían hace muchos años. Y ahí está, siempre subyace la misma tensión. ¿Cuál es el punto de equilibrio, más allá del tamaño del empaque, en un empaque promedio, entre poder poner la información básica, que la persona la lea, y no que en nuestro anhelo por poner más, para dar más seguridad a él, que todos estemos más tranquilos, al final la letra sea microscópica, el ordenamiento sea imposible y la gente no lee nada? Entonces, esta pregunta no tiene respuesta, es básicamente el resultado de un acuerdo, de un equilibrio contradictorio que los gobiernos, con las empresas y las asociaciones tienen que encontrar, tomando riesgos, porque no es que al poner muchísimos caracteres, con mucha información, con letra microscópica, nosotros nos quedamos tranquilos, pero las personas no leen esa caja, ¿no? Entonces, eso claramente no sirve para nada. Obviamente las demandas de las personas a la hora de usar un producto era, ¿no?, para qué sirve, cómo usarlo y cuándo no usarlo, ¿no? Y tal vez elíjese a contestar brevemente esas 3 preguntas, ¿no?, y dejar abierta la puerta a que si necesitan más pueden ir a tal sitio a encontrarlo, como nos contaba Cristina o varios de los expositores. Hoy el acceso a la información vía internet y desde el smartphone es tan grande que vamos en ese lugar, ¿no? No hace falta pretender condensar una Biblia en un empaque de muy pocos centímetros cuadrados de superficie. Bueno, acá les puse algunas gráficas simplemente de lo que estuvimos. Les puse algunas gráficas de lo que estuvimos para que vean lo que va pasando, ¿no? La predisposición de la lectura, obviamente, crece sensiblemente en la medida que la cantidad de información es reducida, ¿no? Fíjense cómo son las curvas, ¿no? El uso de los bullets, ¿no?, de los puntos y señaladores, facilita la comprensión, y el interés en la lectura pasa de porcentajes del 40 hasta el 90 en la medida que vamos reduciendo sensiblemente. Nosotros les habíamos ofrecido a las personas 4 modelos, ¿no? O sea, el modelo actual y 3 modelos donde iban avanzando cada vez con menor cantidad de información, ¿no?, que no quiere decir que fuera insuficiente, pero íbamos reduciendo en un esfuerzo de simplificar. Bueno, el modelo con más compacta la información, fíjense los niveles de ganas de leer o de interés por leerlo, que trepaban a más del 90% cuando los puntos iniciales en todos los países estaban en el 37, el caso más bajo de Brasil, que era este diario de domingo que les contaba. Bueno, sería algo así como Colombia el 63, ¿no?, llegando después a porcentajes del 90. Bueno, otra obviedad, pero que necesitábamos constatarla: el uso del lenguaje coloquial maximiza la comprensión. Esto también, tenemos 1 millón de historias graciosas para contar, pero la gente, más que le hablen de analgésico, pretende que le digan que calma el dolor, ¿no?, que antipirético, que baja la fiebre. Bueno, cuanto más llano y más simple el lenguaje, menor. Esto es otra discusión muchas veces con las agencias y con personas legales de las compañías, porque el lenguaje técnico, a nuestros usuarios y a las personas que utilizan los productos no les importan nuestras discusiones, sino quieren ser llanos, cortos, concretos y simples, ¿no? Por lo cual, si decimos que trabajamos para ellos, nuestra responsabilidad es tratar de producir las cosas, de hacerle la vida lo más fácil posible, y no para cubrirnos nosotros, sino de acuerdo a las necesidades de ellos, ¿no? Fíjense también cómo cambia cómo va variando la curva de comprensión, ¿no?, del 60% promedio, en algunos casos el 28%, y llegan al 90% nuevamente en la medida que el lenguaje es llano y coloquial. Bueno, obviamente una etiqueta simple tiene un impacto muy positivo en la lectura, lo porcentajes, fíjense que son realmente increíbles cómo evolucionaba, ¿no? No pasaba del 12, 17, 25 al 70, 80% de lectura. Eso para contarles un poquito lo que hicimos con etiquetas. Tenemos 9 minutos por delante. Umbrella Brands, lo que venimos haciendo, esta investigación está corriendo ahora, así que simplemente contarles un poquito qué es. Se basa en una investigación muy interesante que se hizo en España, que hizo Pfizer justamente con la Asociación de España y la Agencia de Reguladora de España, que el objetivo fue asegurar la mejor diferenciación y comprensión de las distintas productos de una misma marca paraguas, ¿no? Y básicamente jugó con cuatro elementos diferenciadores, que son el color, la indicación, los principio activo y los potenciales iconos o dibujos que se pudieran hacer, ¿no? Entonces, esto es lo que estamos haciendo ahora. El color, evidentemente, es el primer diferenciador en productos, ¿no?, con una misma marca paraguas. La otra cosa que en los resultados parciales nos está dando como más importante y más positiva para la mejor comprensión es la indicación. Con esto teníamos dudas acerca de si el principio activo aportaba más información o no que la indicación. Claramente los consumidores nos dicen que lo que les sirve mucho más es una indicación en tamaño más grande, porque los principios activos, salvo algunos pocos que son muy conocidos y que ya la gente sabe qué es y para qué funciona, el resto la gente ya no los conoce, ¿no? Sacando los 2 o 3 principales analgésicos y alguno que otro, el resto ya, que nosotros les agrandemos en la caja el principio activo cuando no saben qué es ni para qué es, no les aporta información valiosa. Entonces, gastar esfuerzos en agrandar la tipografía de algo que no siguen sin comprender no aporta utilidad, ¿no? Entonces, el color y la indicación es lo que aporta mayor valor. Y los iconos también resultan muy importantes, aunque con la misma salvedad que les decía en las etiquetas. Hay que asegurarse en testeos de que aporten la información que queremos, porque en algunos casos, ¿no?, se prestan a confusión, ¿no? El clásico ejemplo es el de la mujer, la panza tachada, y que claramente es que no lo pueden tomar personas embarazadas, y algunas piensan que si lo toman no se van a quedar embarazadas, otras. No. Hay un montón de interpretaciones diversas que requieren ser analizadas en profundidad y testeadas antes de avanzar definitivamente a usar eso como aporte de información. En publicidad también, este estudio lo hicimos ya hace un par de años largos, en varios países, en 6 países, fue sumamente interesante. Medimos un montón de cosas, voy a tratar de mostrar las principales, ¿no? Una de las que eran preocupaciones era esta vieja discusión acerca de si los medicamentos de venta libre o de libre acceso, sin prescripción, son un bien de consumo, ¿no? Nosotros defendíamos con nuestra pasión de siempre que no, que, o sea, uno se puede comprar en un free shop un perfume por impulso o una cartera, pero uno no se compra un medicamento por impulso, o sea, básicamente requiere una condición subyacente. Si yo no tengo un dolor de cabeza, si no tengo hongos en los pies, si no tengo piojos, decimos nosotros, no sé si le dicen aquí pediculosis, o sea, no le voy a poner a mi hijo un pediculicida porque sí, porque es lindo el pack, ¿no?, o porque tiene rico sabor un caramelo para la tos, o sea, no se le ocurre a nadie. Entonces, atrás de esta idea, aunque resultara obvio, queríamos hacer un testeo, hicimos unos testeos muy grandes, para ver qué le pasaba. Obviamente la gente distingue perfectamente y sabe que la mayoría amplia de los medicamentos de venta libre, si uno no tiene un problema, no se lo compra. Y en todo caso, la compra impulsiva puede ser para tenerlo en su casa en el momento que lo necesite, pero no es que voy a comprarme cajas y me voy a tirar pastillas como si fuera... esto claramente sale en el estudio. La otra cosa que surgía es otro viejo discusión acerca de si la exageración como recurso publicitario no entraba en conflicto con la sobrepromesa, ¿no? Muchas veces era, pero se sobrepromete que uno se toma una pastilla y en la siguiente toma de la publicidad ya está perfecto. Bueno, mirá, tengo que explicar eso en 15 segundos, no puedo dejar pasar 20 minutos o una hora de publicidad para que la persona entienda. Obviamente las personas, los consumidores entienden perfectamente esta situación. Lo mismo en el caso de celebrities. Hay algunos países que tienen muchas discusiones con el caso de celebrities, si están mal. La realidad es que los consumidores entienden perfectamente, se los muestro, este chart, ¿no?, que sirven para captar la atención. Pero de ahí a que porque lo uso un celebrity, yo me voy a usar un producto si no lo necesito, hay un salto que es insalvable, ¿no? Fíjense el penúltimo renglón, ¿A cuántos lo motiva a usar un producto porque, pues, si no lo necesito, porque usa el Celebrity? Nadie, el 3%. Bueno, acá hay muchas cosas sobre publicidad que es muy linda, pero tenemos poco tiempo, así que prefiero ir avanzando un poco más. Básicamente versa sobre lo mismo, ¿no? Que la gente es mucho más astuta de lo que pensamos, que entiende bastante bien lo que se les muestra en la publicidad, que les sirve para reconocer marcas, para reconocer problemas o dolencias que pueden tener y que los pueden resolver con eso, o que no sabían, y que les aporta una información interesante. Ya para ir terminando, que nos quedan dos temas. Uno, el que sería canales de comercialización. Este es un tema muy interesante y también muy controvertido, que es dónde se pueden vender los medicamentos de libre acceso o de venta libre. Básicamente en Latinoamérica, en casi todos los países, afortunadamente se pueden vender en todos fuera en farmacias y fuera de farmacia. Vieron que hay muchos sistemas en el mundo, hay países donde se pueden vender en todos lados, hay países que algunos medicamentos de venta libre se pueden vender en otros lados, como es el caso de Inglaterra, y otros solo en la farmacia, y hay otros que solo en la farmacia. En esto también se mezcla la situación bien latina que les decía al principio del respeto relativo a la ley, ¿no? Brasil y Argentina son dos casos donde en este momento está prohibido vender fuera de farmacia, pero uno se compra los medicamentos, ciertos medicamentos fuera de farmacia. Y al final esa contradicción y ambivalencia, al único que perjudica son a las personas, porque no termina de entender, ¿no?, qué es lo prohibido y qué es lo permitido, ¿no? Para ser concreto del caso, lo que fuimos viendo, ¿no?, el primer punto de los que compartimos hoy, básicamente muchísima gente compra medicamentos fuera de la farmacia, de estos del libre acceso. Fíjense que aunque los dos países de la derecha en ese momento, Chile y Brasil, estaba prohibido, y fíjense el componente de compra, 91 y 80, y por supuesto que se esgrimen todo tipo, nosotros trabajamos y asistimos a la discusión en Chile, y la realidad que era de un nivel de hipocresía conmovedor, ¿no? Allá hay tres cadenas que monopolizan el mercado de farmacias, y la discusión era, por lo menos la discusión pública, era totalmente sanitaria, y lo único que subyacía era un interés comercial y corporativo, ¿no? Entonces era notable que la discusión fuera 100% sanitaria, cuando el único foco real de discusión era el interés de tres cadenas de preservar su oligopolio. ¿Pasó esto? Ahí vamos. Esto también testeamos el modelo de farmacia, ¿no? Básicamente, si las personas preferían un modelo de farmacia tradicional o más antiguo, donde tienen que ir al mostrador a pedir un medicamento de venta libre, o si prefieren autoservicio, obviamente la preferencia es bastante superior a la del autoservicio. Acá, en el caso de Argentina, avanzamos bastante más, porque por lo menos el gremio de los farmacéuticos allá era muy combativo, diciendo que aún un medicamento de venta libre agarrado de un autoservicio era muy peligroso. Entonces, una asociación de consumidores allá lo que hizo fue una investigación de ir a comprar una caja completa de aspirina, 100, a farmacias que no tenían autoservicio, o sea que se las expendía la persona que atendía, la compraba. Por supuesto que nadie le hacía una pregunta acerca de qué era, para qué era el producto, cómo lo iba a utilizar, nadie, ¿no? Eran 101 farmacias. Después de pagarlo volvía, le decía a la persona que lo atendía, que por lo general no era un farmacéutico, pero en muchos casos también lo era, que en realidad eran para su tía, y que lo único que estaba tomando era un anticoagulante, y el 80% de los casos dejaron que esa persona se fuera comprándose esa aspirina, que era la única contraindicación puntual que tenía, ¿no?, el anticoagulante. Era el 80% de los casos. Por lo cual, esa historia, por lo menos en Argentina, que el valor de la persona que te da la caja de un medicamento de venta libre es decisivo, y que si vos, en cambio, te lo vas y te lo agarrás vos mismo en la estantería, no tenés esa protección, ese consejo, y te vas a morir de una úlcera o de un accidente cerebrovascular, la realidad que es solo retórica, que lo único que hace es defender un interés sectorial que es genuino, pero que es comercial y no tiene un sustento sanitario. Terminando en Switch, estamos terminando, así que avanzando mucho, hemos tratado de generar espacios de experiencias comparadas, donde cada agencia compartía qué moléculas tenía como OTC y los otros países no lo tenían, y era sumamente interesante. recuerdo dos de las que más me gustaron a mí. Una, Brasil, que contaba su caso con Dipirona. Dipirona en Brasil es venta libre hace miles de años. Y obviamente lo usan millones de personas porque es el producto más vendido de ese país, que tiene 200 millones de personas. Y no tiene ninguno de todos los problemas dramáticos que creemos los demás países que producen esa sustancia, pese a ser de venta libre hace 20 años y ser usado en volúmenes impresionantes, porque es un país con una cantidad de gente enorme y es el producto más vendido y más usado del país. O también, me acuerdo que Colombia había presentado acá el doctor y el doctor Álvaro el caso de la pastilla del día después, y fue realmente conmovedor porque era el único país que lo planteó. Y fue el único país, Colombia, que tuvo la inteligencia y la sinceridad de plantear una discusión sin hipocresía, ¿no? Diciendo, miren, nosotros tenemos estos problemas, la verdad que si no es este producto, no quiere decir que sea un producto inocuo, no quiere decir que sea un producto sin riesgos, lo que estamos teniendo en cuenta es priorizando la situación de una persona que está en una situación de urgencia, que no va a abrir un foro familiar para ver si puede utilizar esa pastilla o no, y que es una situación de emergencia, y que si no, probablemente después recurra a peores alternativas para practicarse un aborto de las peores formas, y que si aún eso no funciona, tendremos en nuestro país, Colombia, un chico nacido en las peores condiciones, y todo es una cadena de catástrofes, porque no tenemos la integridad de tener una discusión adulta, sea acerca de cuál es la discusión cuando una chica que tiene 16 o 17 o 18 años tuvo un acto sexual sin protección y se quedó embarazada. Entonces, y donde lo valiente, más allá de las posturas, es por lo menos abordar la discusión con honestidad, ¿no? Y no escondernos atrás de todas moralinas mientras una realidad enorme sigue ocurriendo, ¿no? Entonces creo que ahí hay muchísimo valor. Estoy ya time up, así que no tengo mucho más para dejar. Algunas preguntas para terminar. Me interesa mucho dejarles la idea, lo de publicidad, y lo de, sobre todo, ¿no?, esta idea de tomar decisiones focalizados en la experiencia de las personas, ¿no? No seguir decidiendo desde un escritorio, y esto vale para todos, ¿no? Empresas, asociaciones, agencias, sino tratar de investigar y conocer la realidad dura como es y no las ideas que nosotros tenemos de cómo es la realidad. Tratar de proveerles a los consumidores la información más precisa y en las formas que se lo faciliten lo más posible, ¿no? No cubriendo nuestros temores legales o nuestros anhelos de que sepan todo, sino teniendo en cuenta que ellos quieren poco, y ese poco es mucho más valioso que mucho que no van a considerar. Y trabajar con los sistemas de salud también es un gran llamado de nuestro sector para ver cómo eficientizar los sistemas de salud, ¿no? Para el futuro, algunas preguntas. ¿Cómo abordar el sistema de todo lo que es las redes sociales, ¿no? Y todo lo que está pasando en Internet, que es todo un mundo de información, y la verdad que vamos, no sabemos ni cómo acercarnos, ¿no? Seguimos controlando publicidades que salen a televisión y hay un millón de cosas que no sabemos ni cómo van, ni para dónde van, y ni siquiera nos estamos tomando el trabajo de pensarlas. ¿Qué vamos a hacer con las enfermedades crónicas? La verdad que el uso, ya lo decían varios expositores, los pacientes son especialistas de su propia enfermedad, nadie sabe más que ellos de sus propias dolencias, y hay un rol muy importante que pueden aportar los medicamentos sin prescripción, usados responsablemente y con una adecuación sensata. Y este punto que les había dicho antes también, cómo dejarlo, ¿no? ¿Qué vamos a hacer con estas grandes cantidades de medicamentos que son con prescripción, pero se venden sin prescripción, y lo único que aportan es bastante confusión a cada una de las personas que viven en nuestros países? Bueno, eso es todo. Muchas gracias.
Gracias, Juan. Mensajes claros, concretos, no más allá de lo que necesita la gente, y por encima de todo, definiciones desde el plano regulatorio frente a la publicidad, frente a los mercados. Y yo entiendo eso de los mensajes claros. Me llamó la atención eso de que cuando aparece la barriguita cruzada, no se sabe si es que hace daño en el embarazo o si que tomando eso no se va a embarazar, como el tipo que subía y bajaba la escalera antes de tomar un medicamento, porque en el prospecto decía que agítese antes de usarse, o el tipo que salía a la calle sencillamente a tomarse el medicamento porque aplicarse el medicamento porque decía que solo para uso externo. Entonces, Vamos a una pausa de 15 minutos solamente para que tomen un refrigerio, estiren las piernas. Y quería manifestarle a David que ayer cuando vio que la gente estaba frente a los televisores mirando y que obviamente la alegría que ganara, no sé qué, le cuento a David que si el partido, que si Colombia hubiera perdido, así como perdió Argentina, Juan, se están acostumbrando a perder ustedes, ¿no? Brasil también perdió, pero bueno, eso ya es costumbre. También David, que si Colombia hubiera perdido también había habido vuelta y la gente sin duda también estuviera exaltada aquí. Celebramos, perdamos o no o ganemos, no hay ningún problema. Entonces, 15 minutos, se preparan que vamos a estar hasta la 1:15 aquí. Hoy no hay partido, así que no tenemos que estar de afán, pero es sencillamente para que tengan ustedes presente que después vamos a tener un panel muy interesante.